The Lord be with you. It's good to see you on this warm day, record-breaking warm day. Although it's pretty nice this morning, don't you think? Our gospel text today, Jesus asks Peter, ask the disciples that ever-important question, who do you say that I am? And we'll see what that means for us. Let's prepare our hearts for worship through the brief order of confession and forgiveness. It's found on the third page of the bulletin. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. In the presence of God, who sees our hearts and our minds, let us confess our sin. God, our strength, we confess that we are captive to the power of sin that dwells within us. We put ourselves first and others last. What we think will make us happy leaves us longing for more. Even when we want to do what is good, we find ourselves doing the opposite. Rescue us from death's grip on our lives and raise us up day by day that we may be alive to God in Christ Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters, all have fallen short of the glory of God. Therefore, we are justified by God's grace as a gift. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, in whom we have forgiveness of sin, life, and salvation. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share God's peace by greeting those around you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. In peace, let us pray to the
The Lord be with you. O God, with all your faithful followers of every age, we praise you, the rock of our life. Be our strong foundation and form us into the body of your Son, that we may gladly minister to all the world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I, that is higher.
A reading from Isaiah. Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many. For the Lord will comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places, and will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Listen to me, my people, and give heed to me, my nation, for a teaching will go out from me, and my justice for a light to the peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and for my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath, for the heavens will vanish like smoke, the earth will wear out like a garment, and those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended. The word of the Lord.
Give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. Is the glory of the Lord. trouble, you keep me safe. You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand shall save me.
Reading from Romans. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. The word of the Lord.
Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
You may be seated. I would like to invite the children to come forward. Good morning. In fact, I'm gonna let you. Did you notice today that Jesus started calling the Apostle Peter? He called him Simon. Simon was his formal name, and then he called him Peter. If he was speaking Greek, it would have been Petros. If he was speaking Aramaic, which we believe he was speaking, it would have been Cephas. Cephas in Aramaic is rock. And isn't it interesting that Peter or Petros in Greek is rock? So he said, He called him a rock. So I want you to all take a rock. You can take this home and remember. Yeah, that's a nice one. You can name your rock Peter if you want. There you go, Felix. Jesus said, now there's something going on here. He said, upon this rock, he said, from now on you're going to be called rock, Petros, and upon this rock I will build my church. So just think, a church is built on a rock, Petros or Peter. And we believe that it was his statement of faith that he said to Jesus, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus made a statement, the gates of hell will never prevail against that. That statement of faith, our hope, the gospel of God's love, okay? So nothing will ever prevail against God's love. So remember that when you take this home. You can call your rock Peter, and remember, it's all about his confession of faith that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and nothing can prevail against it. Guess what? We should pray. Everyone, repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for Peter. We thank you for Jesus, the Messiah. We thank you that not even hell can prevail against your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. You can keep that, Felix. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. There are questions, and our text today is a great question. Who do you say that I am? Probably the question that you hear most last couple of days is, how hot is it? Well, it's so hot when Mick and I were going to have popcorn last night, it was popped before it got to the microwave. Or ran to the grocery store to get a loaf of bread, and by the time it got home, it was toast. Some of you remember the country western singer, Waylon Jennings. Let's see if this will work. Waylon Jennings. Oh, he started having hits back in the 70s. And Will Campbell was a Baptist pastor who got himself into trouble constantly, but also was an author. For instance, Will Campbell, during the 60s, he marched with Martin Luther King Jr. He was one of the few white people that stood alongside the children that were marched into the schools when, during the time of desegregation in Arkansas. And when he did that, of course, he had all kinds of hate mail from people who were racists. And then he realized it isn't good to have people hate you, especially some of these people claim to be Christians. So he went and befriended the Ku Klux Klan. And he hung out with them and tried to be a little bit of a chaplain to them. And then, of course, he got all kinds of hate mail from the people on the left. So that's what the kind of person Will Campbell is. So he decided he was going to hang out with Waylon Jennings and become Waylon Jennings' unofficial chaplain. And he would tour with Waylon Jennings. And so one day he asked Waylon, "Waylon, what do you believe about Jesus?" And Waylon Jennings just said, "Uh-huh." It's the answer he gave. About a month later, he asked him again, "What do you believe about Jesus?" And Waylon Jennings just simply said, "Uh-huh." Another month later, he asked them the same question, "Waylon, what do you believe about Jesus?" And Waylon said, "Uh-huh." And then he said, "All those books you write and all those books you read, have they improved upon Jesus?" And Will Campbell said, "No, not really." And Waylon Jennings simply said, "I believe in Jesus." That was his answer. Now, when we are asked that question, what do you believe about Jesus? Or if Jesus asked us, "Who do you say that I am?" How would you answer that? There's three belief statements. I wanted to make sure my slides were where I was. There's three belief statements in this story today. Really quite incredible. The first is Simon Peter's belief statement. He said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." A statement about his belief in Jesus. Now, did he wander and struggle with that belief sometimes? Yes. But that was his belief statement. But probably a just as incredible belief statement was this one, Jesus' statement about Peter. "You are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church." Jesus is putting an awful lot of confidence in Peter. Many people, in fact, most Christians, interpret that belief statement that Jesus made in Peter to the church. So in a sense, Jesus is saying, "You, Messiah Lutheran Church, you are the ones in whom I build my church." So isn't that a tremendous belief statement that God in Christ believes in us, to entrust to us the very gospel, the treasure that he builds his church upon? And isn't that what we try to convey to our children year after year after year through Sunday school, through confirmation, through youth ministry, even through our child care center. The third thing is this statement. The gates of death, the gates of hell cannot prevail against the gospel. God's love will always be there. Three tremendous belief statements. Peter's trust in God, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." God's trust by entrusting to us the treasure of the gospel. So great a treasure, it cannot be destroyed. Let's look at three people. Anne Lamont had been living quite a rough life, raised in the church, but had since left the church and was living quite a rough life, and and made it back to the church and became a successful author. And then she made a statement that she made her 14-year-old son go to church. And of course, all kinds of people criticized her for that. How can you make someone go to church? How could you possibly do that to your son? Make him go to church. And she simply said this. Of course, the people were accusing her of oppressing her child, abusing him by making him go to church. And she simply said, left to their own, teenagers would opt out of many important things like flossing their teeth and homework. It's good to do uncomfortable things. It's weight training for life. Teens who don't go to church miss opportunities to see people loving God back. Learning to love back is the hardest part of being alone. Anne Lamont, I think, understood this great treasure that we've been entrusted to. She even made her 14-year-old go to church because she wanted him to understand that treasure, to love God back. I think all those are answers to those three confessions in our gospel lesson today. Elaine Pagels. Elaine is a scholar who looks at all the variant readings that we have out there of the Gospels, like the Gospel of Thomas, and she writes scholarly books about them. And one of her books, Beyond Belief, she began it by talking about her life. And she had been away from the church for a while, even though she was a scholar that looked at these documents, both the Bible and others. And she had been away for quite a long time, and one morning she was running, getting her exercise, but it was a cold day, so she stopped. She thought she'd just go inside a church and warm herself. She went into an Episcopal church, and there it hit her. Just 2 days beforehand, she had found out that her 2-year-old son had an incurable, fatal lung condition. She said, standing there, she had not been in church for a long time, and she was startled by her response to the worship in progress. And she goes on to describe it, and she goes on to describe her son Mark's condition and the despair that she was having over that. And then she wrote this: standing in the back of that church, I recognized, uncomfortably, that I needed to be there. Here was a place to weep without imposing tears upon a child. And here was a heterogeneous community that had gathered to sing, to celebrate, to acknowledge common needs, and to deal with what we cannot control or imagine. I think she was understanding. She needed that treasure, the gospel, that not even the gates of Hades, death itself, could prevail against. In the news, we've had some high-profile deaths. Michael Brown, tragic death, seemed like a senseless death. I tried to find out something about his faith. The only thing I could find out were a couple of sentences that said he had been a born-again Christian. The other one is James Foley, the reporter that was beheaded. James Foley was raised Roman Catholic. He went to Marquette University, a Roman Catholic university. He was very devout. He had gone to Libya. And the reason he went there as a reporter was he said he cared about the suffering of an oppressed people. And he wanted to report on that and see if he could shed some light on that. He was captured there and was held for 45 days. And then, of course, he went on to Syria. And his editor even begged him not to go. And he said, no, I need to write about the suffering of an oppressed people. So I looked up a little bit on his faith, this devout Roman Catholic. And he did write something after his first time in prison with in Libya. And he was allowed one phone call. And this is a story about that phone call that he made. He wrote, "I prayed my mom would know I was okay. I prayed I could communicate through some cosmic reach of the universe to her. I began to pray the rosary. It was what my mother and my grandmother would have prayed." You could see how even in their praying of the rosary, they were trying to extend to their children this treasure, the gospel. "I said 10 Hail Marys between each Our Father. It took a long time, almost an hour, to count 100 Hail Marys off on my knuckles." By the way, I'm not necessarily recommending you pray the rosary, but he certainly found it helpful. "It helped to keep my mind focused," he wrote. Claire, that was another prisoner, "Claire and I prayed together out loud. It felt energizing to speak our weaknesses and hopes together, as if in a conversation with God rather than silently and alone." And then he was given his phone call, his one phone call. So he dialed the phone. "I said a final prayer and dialed the number. My mom answered the phone. Mom, it's me, Jim. Jimmy, where are you? I'm still in Libya, Mom. I'm sorry about this, so sorry." "Don't be sorry, Jim," she pleaded. "Oh, Daddy just left. Oh, he wants to talk to you. How are you, Jim?" I told her I was being fed, that I was getting the best bed and being treated like a guest. "Are they making you say these things, Jim?" "No, the Libyans are beautiful people. I've been praying for you to know that I'm okay," I said. "Haven't you felt my prayers?" "Oh, Jimmy, so many people are praying for you. All your friends, Donnie, Michael, Joyce, Dan, Hanaran, Suri, Tom Darkin, Sarah Fang, have been calling. Your brother Michael loves you so much." She started to cry. "The Turkish embassy is trying to see you, and also Human Rights Watch. Did you see them?" I said I hadn't. "They're having a prayer vigil for you at Marquette. Don't you feel our prayers?" she asked. "I do, Mom. I feel them. And I thought about this for a second. Maybe it was others' prayers strengthening me, keeping me afloat." Then he went on to say that it was his prayer, it was his faith that helped make sense of everything. And it was his faith that held things together. I believe Jim Foley knew that the gates of death could not prevail against the gospel, against God's love, against God's mercy. Yes, the Apostle Peter made a great confession. "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." God Almighty made a great confession. Upon this rock I will build my church. And then, with great trust, he entrusted not only Peter, but us with the treasure of the kingdom. Amen.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son. Filled by the Spirit, let us join the whole people of God in Christ Jesus in praying for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Lord of life, give a discerning spirit to our congregation as we prepare for outreach ministries, programming for families and youth, and meaningful worship.
Teach us to use our grace-given talents with generosity, compassion, and humility. Assign each member a measure of faith to make your vision a reality. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Your Spirit blows over all the wild places of the earth, reminding us who is in control.
Preserve the wilderness areas and coastlands and help us minimize our impact upon the land. Lord, in your mercy.
Transform all nations by renewing the minds of their people.
In the wake of the killing of American journalist James Foley, we pray for those who are kidnapped, especially the long-term disappeared, and for their families. We pray for the rescuers combing through the site of landslides triggered by rain in Hiroshima, Japan. For those clearing up from the flash flooding in Phoenix, Arizona. As the Ebola epidemic in Western Africa continues to spread, we rejoice that there is treatment and people survive. As we hear of riots in Ferguson, Missouri, and in Liberia, for widely differing reasons, we encounter something of the fear there is in all of our lives over inequality and injustice. We pray for peace and reconciliation among all people. Lord, in your mercy.
Stretch out your hand to send healing and care to those in need.
We remember those who are ill, Joanne Allen, Odella Arnold, Alton Bernal, Lael Biela, Betty Carlton, Gail Davidson, Betty Evans, Zamir Godfrey, Bobby Jameson, Vera Kimsey, Jim Lampe, Dorothy Lokensgaard, Elaine Mitchell, Jack Snyder, and Mary Thomas. Are there any others?
We give you heartfelt thanks for the diligent leadership and faithful service of those who have died and now rest in you.
Comfort those who mourn, especially the family and friends of Leroy Dykeman, Richard McFall, and Joe Sfigera. Lord, in your mercy. Into your loving hands, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abundant mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. to the brim our cup of blessing, gather the harvest.
God of mercy and grace, the eyes all wait upon you, and you open your hand in blessing. Fill us with good things at your table, that we may come to the help of all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Be holy, holy. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come. You may be seated.
body of Christ given for you. 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 Keep you. Body of Christ given for you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
We thank you, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have fed us in a way our hearts can understand with the saving body and blood of Jesus Christ. Enliven us by your presence in this meal, that we may be your presence in the world through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
For those of you that let me back up. On Tuesday at 11 o'clock, we have a Bible study that anyone is invited to come to. We had planned this week to do something special, and that was to meet over at Bobby Jameson's house and meet out by her pool. But because of the heat, Bobby has thought that we would probably be more comfortable here at the church. So those of you that concerns, we're going to meet here at the church on Tuesday. On September 6th, God's Work Our Hands, it's supposed to be a something that goes on throughout all the ELCA congregations throughout the United States, and we are going to do some a few outreach projects. Notice that there are going to be projects on the inside for those of you that don't want to be out doing physical labor. And then there is going to be a neighborhood cleanup. We've notified our neighbors that if they have debris they're trying to get rid of in their yards and whatnot, put it out by the curb and we'll come by and pick it up. Which would be the next thing. Matt Coleman is in charge of that aspect of the group. So if you have a trailer or a pickup truck and would be available for 2-3 hours on that Saturday morning, see Matt. I don't have any other announcements unless you have something. Good. Receive this benediction. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the grace that sustains every breath we take, the love of God that gives us courage and strength, and the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit that fills our hearts with comfort and peace be with you and all those you care about, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Guided by the gospel, we... Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Members of local congregations came together to work in this community garden on the north side of Chicago. As ELCA members, we do the work of serving our neighbors and making the world a better place every day. We're kind of an undercover force for good. But on God's Work Our Hands Sunday, we can come out in our yellow-shirted thousands and have the opportunity to do this work together. Whether we plant gardens in urban communities, write letters to veterans and soldiers, or serve meals to people who are food insecure, we dedicate this day each year to be church together, church for the sake of the world. Serving together, we do God's work of restoring and reconciling communities in Jesus' name throughout the world. So join us on Sunday, September 7th for God's Work Our Hands Sunday as we witness to the love of God who knows and loves each one of us. Hey, nice shirt.
Thanks.
Yellow, wear it, share it.